So in John chapter 12, Sherry read it for us. It's coming off of chapter 11 that we talked about, which is perhaps Jesus' greatest miracle, okay, short of his own resurrection. In chapter 11 of John, Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. We talked about that the rabbis of that time taught that the spirit hovered over a dead person's body for 3 days, and it was possible to be revived in that time, but once it got to 4 days, it was impossible. So Jesus, waiting to the fourth day to revive Lazarus, to raise him from the dead, it cemented in their minds the miraculous nature of his power, right, in the mind of all the witnesses. And we noted how at first when he came upon the scene, everybody mourning, Lazarus wrapped in burial clothes and in the tomb, that he was troubled by it. We talked about what that meant, that he was troubled. He was seeing firsthand, as fully God, fully human, seeing death through human eyes, right? The ravages of death. And he has come to eradicate that death forever. So Jesus, as he's troubled, he isn't frustrated. He's not angered at the people for their lack of faith, right? He's not discouraged, but he's angered at death. And he's come to do something about it. And he is the resurrection and the life. And so that's what Jesus taught us last week. So Jesus is the resurrection and the life. What does that mean? It means that he doesn't just grant life. He does, but he doesn't just do that. He doesn't just point us to life like, I know where you can go. I got a guy. Follow me. No, he is the life. I am the resurrection and the life, Jesus says. I am. And by the way, that's an exclusive title. There is no other religion, there's no other guru that can declare that. They can declare it, but it isn't true. There is one person, the God-man Jesus, who is the resurrection and the life. No one else has that title. Not Muhammad, not Buddha, not Mary, or any other imposter. Only Jesus. And we can celebrate as Christians, right, the freedom for people in this country to worship however they see fit. We ought to line up at the voting booth and vote for that freedom for people to worship however they see fit. When religious belief is under attack and the freedom of religious expression is under attack, even if it's towards people that we don't agree with, we don't believe what they believe, we should line up for their freedom to be able to worship. But all roads don't lead to heaven, okay? And so that needs to be said. All roads don't lead to heaven. The only way to heaven, the exclusive way to heaven, is through the resurrection and the life. And if you don't believe that and you don't like that, I understand, but that's what Jesus said. So either you take it from him or you leave it. But he's the resurrection and the life. Now, before we get to chapter 12, I got to set the stage for you for what Sherry read and help you understand the climate and the emotion that's building around Jesus and what's happening with Lazarus' resurrection. All of this is leading up to Jesus' final week on earth, right before the cross. The resurrection of Lazarus has caused a tremendous uproar among the people. In chapter 11, if you have your Bibles open, just flip back over there. Look there, verse 45. Because of Lazarus' resurrection, we're told that many, many people believed in Jesus. They believed he was who he said he was, right? And so as a result, many believed. So many people believed that the chief priests and the Pharisees, the religious leaders who are kind of running this little game, they gather and they ask themselves, what are we going to do about this? Because we got a problem. People aren't following us, they're following Jesus. And so they gather and say, what are we to do? And I love this verse. We didn't get to it last week, and it helps us understand what's about to happen. So look at verse 48, chapter 11. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. Oh no, right? Like, oh. And the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. So that is an astounding verse. The selfishness and the arrogance are almost impressive, right? Like, if we let him go on like this, we'll go on like what? If we let him go on healing people, if we let him go on like raising the dead and making people who've been blind from birth and lame from birth, if we go on letting him help people and improve their lives, it's not going to look good for us, right? Like, we'll be out of a job if he keeps doing this good stuff. And I love that because, like, they said the quiet part out loud. You know, like the stuff you're not supposed to say out loud, like you're supposed to pretend like you care. They were beyond that. Like if we let him keep doing this and helping people, we're going to be out of a job. And our jobs are most important. And then on top of that, the arrogance. So we have the selfishness, we have the arrogance too, right? If we let him go on like this. What do you mean? What do you mean let him go on like this? This is the man who said to the massive storm in the Sea of Galilee, stop. And it stopped instantly, like dead calm. Who does that? He just raised Lazarus from the dead just by his voice. You think you let him do that? I was reading this week and just laughing at the brashness of that statement, like, are we going to let him continue to do this? You didn't let him do anything. It reminded me of that old Western, Tombstone. It was a great Western, right? It's like filled with like the best one-liners, like, I'm your Huckleberry, right? Like, say when, Johnny Ringo, say when, right? You know? And yeah, it's a great movie. I was just thinking, like, I got to show my kids that movie. And in that movie, Sheriff Behan, who was in the pocket of the crooks, and they're oppressing this town, he tells Wyatt Earp and his brothers and Doc Holliday that they were being arrested for stopping criminal actions, that they were being arrested. And Earp simply responds, like, I'm not going to let you arrest me today, right? Like, that ain't happening. And that reminds me of this statement, like, we're going to let him, you ain't let him do nothing. What are you talking about? You're going to let him do anything. They know that too. They know it and they're afraid. They're talking like they're in control, but they're afraid. They're acting like they're not afraid, but they're afraid. And as the kids say, no cap, right? Like they are just straight afraid. He's declared this in John chapter 10. They heard this. They know it. In John chapter 10, he's like calling a shot like, look, this reason, the Father loves me. I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me. You're not letting me do anything. You're not taking anything from me. Nobody takes this life from me. I will lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. Calling a shot like, oh, I won't be down for long. I'm coming back. That's what's going to happen. This I've received from my Father. Nobody took Jesus' life, and I want to make sure that we get that, right? Like, even as we think about the cross, and we'll get to it here in John in several weeks, but nobody took Jesus' life. He laid it down, right? On the cross, Jesus was the one who decided it's finished. He's the one. The Romans didn't decide that. The Pharisees didn't decide that. Jesus decided it's finished. Not the Romans, not the stooges in this text, their position of power, their false religious system. It's all being threatened, and it's all going to be destroyed by this carpenter. So they're afraid. In verse 53 of chapter 11, we're told, from that day on, they make plans to put him to death. He can't keep going on like this. We got to kill him. That's what they decide. And so that's important for us as we get into chapter 12. The Passover is at hand. This is their high, just holiday. Many Jews are traveling from all over to Jerusalem, celebrating, right, their deliverance from Egypt. When the angel passes over the door of those who have the blood of the Lamb on the doorpost, they're celebrating the Passover. And many Jews have traveled, and they expect Jesus to come too. So these officials put out a warrant for his arrest. And once they arrest him, they're going to kill him. And chapter 12 marks the end of what we call Jesus' public ministry. The rest of John's gospel, and it's almost half a book, the rest of John's gospel covers the last week of Jesus' life right before the cross. The rest of it does. It's almost half. So this is a transition to like the greatest week in human history. And John takes almost half of his book to cover that final week. And so it's going to be a great next several weeks as we kind of jump into that. But we can't forget what's just occurred. Therefore, in chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, therefore ties back to chapter 11, right? So we read chapter 12 with the final words of chapter 11 in our mind. They want him dead. Jesus knows they want him dead. Jesus is traveling to Bethany. He hasn't been to Bethany since Lazarus was raised from the dead. And they're throwing this great dinner, this great celebration in Jesus' honor. Now, Bethany is only 2 miles from Jerusalem. We know the officials are plotting his death. They're not that far away. In a week, the cross is coming. He knows it's coming, and he still goes to Bethany. John wants us to read all of this with that in mind. Read all of it with that in mind, that Jesus knows what's coming. He's foreshadowing for us, right? The championship rounds of Jesus' battle with death are a few days away, and Jesus knows it. And the tension in the text, it's mounting for us. The physical pain, the weight of our sin on his shoulders, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? All of it's coming, and it's coming in a few short days. There's no more time for games. The time is now. Makes chapter 12 even more powerful when we think about that, because we have Jesus moving into danger. We have Jesus moving towards death. We have Jesus leaning into pain, not away from it. We have him moving towards death, not away from it. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. Nobody takes it from him. He lays it down. Look, listen, so you want to serve God faithfully? You're a Christ follower? This is what the Christian life looks like. Way too many of us, me included, want a life without struggle, a life without pain. So one of the ways we kind of insulate ourselves from that is we prevent ourselves from entering into real relationships with other people. Real relationships that involve give and take, real relationships that leave us vulnerable to pain and betrayal, right? We don't have any time for that. So instead, we kind of distance ourselves and keep ourselves busy with things that don't matter for eternity. We turn all of our attention like onto our pets and things like that, and we don't invest in people. It's an inconvenience. It hurts. Wounded people hurt people. Why would I want to be vulnerable and be wounded by others, dragged down in their pain, right? Is there a time to separate ourselves from people like that? Absolutely. But too many of us, yours included, right, we try to arrange our life in such a way where we're not involved in any of that. I'm just saying, if you follow Jesus, this is what life looks like. Jesus left heaven, plopped himself right down in the middle of all of it. The sin and the drama, the pain and the death and the betrayal. What drew his attention? What drew his focus? Time and time again, his attention was focused on the outcast, the despicable, the toxic, the undeserving. He is truly a friend of sinners. His heart is towards sinners. Do you follow Jesus? Then follow him into the pain of others. It's a costly devotion that we're called to. Look at verse 1 of chapter 12. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. So they gave a dinner for him there. And Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those reclining with him at the table. So they're having this great dinner in Jesus' honor. It's a dinner for him, and you can imagine that most likely the entire village is invited to this. So this is a costly celebration that Jesus' friends Mary and Martha and Lazarus are throwing in his honor. They're celebrating his return. These are good friends of Jesus, close friends, right? They're grateful for the miracle, the resurrection of Lazarus. And as you read this text here, you notice these kind of principal players, Mary and Martha and Lazarus. And they're doing what we know them to do from like other times when they're described in Scripture. Martha here has a servant's heart, right? She served. In other places, we see that about Martha. When there's something happening, Martha is serving. She's helping. She's busy doing. She's working. That's what Martha does. Jesus is coming, and for Martha, her heart immediately turns to like acts of service. Like, how can I help? How can I make this ready? How can I have this celebration be all that it needs to be to honor Jesus? So you can think perhaps like her role is like hostess, overseeing all of the festivities. And I just want to take a moment and say I'm thankful for the many people in our church who serve like Martha, who do what needs to be done, who see what needs to be done, and they do it without fanfare, without celebration. They do it because they love God and they love people. Our church, in part, is what it is because of the many people who serve like Martha. Martha's sleeves rolled up, right? Folks in our church that serve like that, a wedding, a funeral, a baby shower, no one needs to ask, and you serve. And the church is blessed immensely by your quiet, faithful service. The dinner here goes on in large part because of Martha. Even the funding for this, because of that family, right? Provided by the family, willingly, joyfully. Our church runs as the result of many people just like that. Then you have Lazarus, right, doing what he does. What's he doing in the text? Well, he's laying down, right? That's kind of what Lazarus does. Probably had to move every so often, right? Or people are like, man, did he die again? You know, like, oh, like, you know, hey, you good? You good to go? I was at I was preaching at a church several years back, and we went to lunch at a house with the pastor and his family, his extended family. Their great, great, great grandpa lived with them, and he was 100. And I felt like, it's kind of like sitting next to Lazarus at a banquet because he was 100, and there were two or three times like we all thought he was dead in the meal, you know, because your grandpa moving, and, you know, then he kind of wake up and we're good to go. You know, he finishes mashed potatoes, and I think for some people, maybe, they, you know, Lazarus, you okay? Of course, I'm kidding about Lazarus. Jesus healed him. He wasn't clinging to life. But what we have Lazarus doing here is he's reclining with Jesus, and that's kind of lost on us. What does that mean? All right, he's reclining with Jesus as they sit at the table. He's kind of his elbows on the one side and his feet are away from the table, right? It's the same for Lazarus and the same for Jesus. This would be important in a moment, but nothing else is special is recorded of Lazarus except that he's reclining with Jesus. What does that mean? It means that Jesus counts him as a very dear, close friend, that Lazarus sits right with him, right by him. Jesus has a good friend in Lazarus. Right? Nothing specific. Now, all the leaders, they want Lazarus dead. His resurrection has made so many people believe in Jesus. They view Lazarus about as much of a threat to them as Jesus, and they want him dead. They want him eradicated. He was a powerful witness to Jesus' saving power, and every single breath testified to his resurrection power. So they want him dead. In verse 10, we understand that Lazarus' life's in danger. He doesn't know it, but it's in danger. Look at verse 3. Mary, therefore, as they're reclining at table, Mary took a pound of expensive ointment made from pure nard and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, he who was about to betray him, said, why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, and having charge of the money bag he used to help himself to what was put into it. Jesus said, leave her alone, so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. For the poor you always have with you, but you do not always have me. So in this portion of the text, we have Mary. What's her role? Mary's doing exactly what we often see her do in the text when we read about her. She is at the feet of Jesus. In other places, we have her sitting at Jesus' feet, learning alongside all of the men, worshiping. Mary's was a deep devotion to Jesus. Listen, there is a lot of emphasis right now in Christian circles on doing, on being the hands and the feet of Jesus, serving, being active, being in the community. And listen, that is all well and good. I want you to understand that is an important part of the church that is sometimes neglected. But it's not like, are you sitting or are you doing? And one, you're a stronger Christian. No, both of those things are part of Christianity. And we have that highlighted in this text. And another example, when Martha's serving and she's like getting stuff happening and Mary's sitting at Jesus' feet, Martha's like, Jesus, would you tell her to get up and help me? And Jesus rebukes Martha. Like, there's a time to sit and to worship. And one of the things we learn from Mary here is exactly what she does. She knows that. She has a deep devotion. I want to point out how Mary is praised for sitting and listening. Worship, gathered worship as a church, it fuels our service of others. So for Mary, her Lord is here, and she's going to worship at his feet, and she's going to tend to him. Look, much of the travel in ancient times was by foot. And on arid and dusty land, feet with open sewage, feet became filthy. Feet were so filthy in ancient times, even slaves were not required to wash the feet of their masters. That's how filthy feet were considered, and quite frankly, they were in ancient times. But Mary sees her Lord. Maybe he seems troubled. Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, they're all family. They're very good friends with Jesus. And you know what it's like when you have a really good friend, you know when something's wrong. You know when they are bothered by something that they're not putting into words. And it's quite possible that Mary sees the very face of Jesus, can tell that he's troubled, or maybe it's just simply out of joy that he's raised her brother Lazarus from the dead. Whatever it is, she does the unimaginable. She takes what amounts to 12 ounces of this expensive ointment perfume, like a Pepsi can size, worth costly, extravagant perfume. Perhaps this is a reflection of their wealth, because it appears that they're quite a wealthy family. Perhaps this is a family heirloom that's been passed down from generation to generation. But without hesitation, moved by her devotion to Jesus, Mary breaks it open, and she pours all of it on Jesus. All of it. Perfume of the highest quality. Typically, a single drop placed on the forehead would have provided a powerful and strong smell for quite a long time. It covered people who did not have modern soaps, people who did not have modern bathing techniques, didn't have modern deodorants. So even a drop of this powerful ointment would have been quite overwhelming to people. But Mary takes the family heirloom, worth a year's wage, something in the equivalent of modern day of around $30,000, maybe as much as that or even more. And she pours all of it on Jesus. Now, in Matthew and Mark, in their gospel, they record it as Jesus' head, that she pours it on Jesus' head. Here, we're told it's his feet. And so people will say, like, well, look, there's a contradiction. Where's the story? And the answer is it kind of provides us all of it. We understand what happens here. Most likely, she started at Jesus' head, and the perfume traveled all the way to her feet, to his feet. Or she poured it all the way down to his feet. But For John, the emphasis is on the cost of the ointment and on Mary's humble, extravagant, costly devotion. The quantity of the perfume, all of it, the quality of the perfume, it combined to have this lasting impact on everyone in the room. Verse 3, look what we're told. The entire house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. Can I tell you, this would have followed Jesus for days. During the triumphal entry that we're going to get to here, perhaps even to the upper room, even on him as he poured out his heart in the garden, perhaps even all the way to the crucifixion, this ointment, this smell would have followed Jesus. The house is filled with this fragrance of the perfume. And imagine with me for a moment what a blessing this was to Jesus. Have you ever had something just weighing on you, just following you, because you know it's coming? You know it's coming, and it's a weight. It's a giant weight on your shoulders, and of course you have. And some of you may have that today, and yet you're here, and it follows you, and you feel like you carry that weight alone, only to have someone come along, and they don't know your pain, they don't know your hurt, but they do something so kind and so thoughtful. It lifts your spirit so much. They're oblivious to the struggle, but they care, and they want to bless. Deeply, truly, they bless you. And an act of kindness, an act of love, an act of thoughtfulness, it moves you with emotion. Well, imagine what it's like to carry the weight of the cross. His death was imminent. The cross was coming. And even his closest friends, in spite of what he said so far, they don't appear to get it. They appear oblivious to it. And so Jesus is reclining at this table, no doubt with this in the back of his mind, and for Mary to anoint him with this perfume, to wipe his feet clean with it, right? What ministry to the physical needs of Jesus. What a sight that must have been to see, and what a blessing that was to Jesus. Mary, she comes face to face with the majesty and the glory of Jesus, and it moves her to a costly devotion. The whole house is affected by her devotion. It's filled with the fragrance of her worship. It's filled with the fragrance of her offering to Christ. And I think we should take a moment here and be challenged as Christians by the costly, extravagant devotion of Mary. It seems like every time we read about her, she's sitting at his feet, learning, growing because of an encounter with God. And this moves her to this costly devotion. $30,000 gone in an instant. Mary's devotion was so costly that she offered the best she had. And we need to understand this, that she's not praised because of the price. The dollar amount is not the issue, right? Too many of us sit on the sidelines and we say things and make excuses like, if I had really extravagant things to give, I would give them. I would be more active, I'd be faithful, I'd give, man, if I win the lottery, I'm really going to give something to God because then it'll be meaningful. That's not how it works with God. We have the widow praised, right, in the gospel for giving her two pennies, her all that she had. The cost, right, in and of itself is not the point, right? What is your most valuable possession, right? What is it? Maybe it's an asset. Maybe it's an account. Perhaps your most valuable possession is your lifestyle. Break it open. Pour it out in devotion to Jesus. Is your most costly possession your standing? You know, for the chief priests and the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they were worried about their standing being affected. They were worried that they were going to lose power. So they were willing to do whatever it took to finish that, to kill Jesus. To don't hide your devotion to Jesus because of fear of man. Could it cost you to rearrange your priorities so your relationship with God is first above all else? Should you pour out maybe your schedule, your time, and offer it up to Jesus? Whatever it is, break it open. Pour it out in costly devotion to Jesus. He is truly worthy. In losing your life, in losing your priorities, you'll find it. You'll find life. Mary has come face to face with Jesus, and she's laying down her rights. She's offering her life in devotion. Seeing his glory is the source of all humble service, was one pastor says. Mary's devotion is so costly, it's so extravagant, that Judas is appalled by it. He's literally appalled by it. From the other Gospels, it appears as if many in the room are appalled by this, okay? So, you know, kind of like the whole, oh, what a waste. You know what we could do with that? Do you know how many people could be helped with that? What a waste that this is. But Judas is moved to speak because he's so appalled. And in our text, John now has the hindsight, because this is written years later. He has the hindsight, and he sees this as a revelation of Judas' character, right? So with great indignity and great piety, Judas chimes in. This could have been used more wisely on the poor. Why would you do this and pour this all out on Jesus' feet? He's disgusted with this devotion. He doesn't understand this kind of devotion. He's never been devoted to Jesus. Listen to me. Genuine devotion is always threatening to other people. People are unnerved by somebody that's committed to something, somebody that's sold out to Jesus. Judas was. Other people in the world or in the room were. Genuine devotion is threatening to others. Genuine devotion seldom goes unchallenged. It seldom goes uncriticized. And so you can imagine what's happening there. Oh, this has to be for attention. She's just trying to get in his good graces. Mary is such a kiss-up. What a waste of resources. Judas is offended by Mary's devotion. John reveals the reason why he's offended. He's skimming off the purse. They travel and minister because of the donations of mostly wealthier individuals, but all people that want to give to the ministry. And Judas was the one in charge of the purse. And what we're told here is that Judas was a thief, that he continually took from the purse. He stole from it. None of the disciples knew. Jesus knew, but nobody else did. Judas' God was money, and he stole. And so he sees here really $30,000 being poured out like that. Man, if you sold this, we could use it for the poor, meaning I could take 25% and put it in my pocket. He's watching that perfume be poured out. He's seeing a giant payday go by. Mary is all about what she can give Jesus. Judas is all about what he can get from Jesus. Judas is hanging around. Judas is with Jesus because he's getting rich off of it by stealing. Judas is threatened by that kind of devotion. Listen, Christian, there ought to be something convicting about your life to people that don't know Jesus. Your humble pursuit maybe of holiness, of living differently, your costly devotion to Jesus, to the church, your commitment to love hard people. I don't know why it is what you do, why you care about people like that just hurts you. What is it? They're unnerved by that kind of devotion. Why do you give every Sunday to gather with people at church? Why do you give some of your income to the church? I don't get it. Our devotion to Jesus ought to be unnerving to people that are outside the church. It ought to convict others. It ought to be unsettling. Mary's act of devotion will be the final straw for Judas. He didn't get fame for following Jesus like he thought. You know, Jesus was like, you know, all these things were happening and all the crowds that were following, this could be a good deal for me. I'm going to hang around for a while. He didn't get the money that he thought he'd get for following Jesus. So he steals, and his genuine heart is revealed through all of this. He went out from them, not because he was a believer who fell away. Or 1 John tells us, right? He went out from them because he wasn't really one of them. And it's most likely immediately following this event, or let me say it's quite likely that immediately following this event with those leaders that want him dead, that Judas strikes the deal for 30 pieces of silver. This is probably the final catalyst where this takes place. Not only does he give nothing to Jesus, he's going to sell Jesus. Listen, if you're thinking about Christianity, is what's in it for me? How does this improve, like, my job standing? How does this improve my financial well-being? If you're thinking, like, that's why you want to be around Jesus, then you're like Judas. Jesus' words then to Judas next, they trouble some people. And it's a difficult verse. Look at verse 7. Leave her alone, Jesus says. As Judas is, like, berating her publicly. Leave her alone. Jesus just said, like, let's give it to the poor. Leave her alone so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. For the poor you always have with you. Like, Jesus said that? Yes, he said that. The poor you always have with you? Like, don't worry about them. There's always going to be poor people. But you only have me for a short while. You do not always have me. This is kind of a difficult verse for some people. What does he mean by this? And some have taken it like the other way, like, see, we don't actually have to really, we always have the poor, so it's not really that big a deal. That's not what Jesus is saying. What Jesus is doing here is pushing against the idea of, like, that worship isn't important. Like, couldn't you just, that devotion, you just poured that all out on Jesus, worshiping at his feet like that? Isn't it more important to just give all that to the poor? And Jesus is saying, no, devotion and worship is equally important. The pressing issues of the day, whatever they are, should not prevent us from worship. So it's not like, it's kind of like, I don't have time for church, okay? There's all these people hurting out there, and I don't have time to meet in a building and be part of a church. I'm trying to be out there being the church. This is what Jesus is condemning, okay? Devotion is just as important as service, and service is just as important as devotion, but devotion fuels our service. And so this verse has a word for us today. It has a word for a bunch of Bible Belt Christians that we all live with. Hey, do you go to church? Yeah, I got a church. Or do you go to church right now? No, I don't really go to church right now, but it's my church. Okay, well, why don't you come to our church and you can still not go to your church, right? And you can still pretend, okay? You can do that. It's got a word for, I don't have time for church. I'm busy being the church. Okay, that's a Judas line. You understand? That's a Judas line. Is there an important role of being the church? 100%. But gathering together locally with God's people is important to Jesus. Entire books of the New Testament are written about what that should look like. And so Jesus is condemning that kind of thought. I don't have time to be together in the church. I'm being the church. Part of being the church is gathering with the church. It's a costly devotion. That's what Jesus is saying here. The pressing issue of the day should not prevent us from worship. Jesus would be gone in a few days. There would be much time to tend to the poor. Much of Jesus' ministry was to the outcast. Of course he's not condemning ministry to the poor. You can't follow Jesus and not have a heart for outcasts, not have a heart for those who are in poverty, who are struggling, who are the victims of great injustice. If you follow Jesus, your heart is for those people, and you're thinking of ways to minister and to help and to save them, to bring them out of that. But that's not all it is. Mary has it right. You see, genuine worship fuels service. When you and I get a glimpse of Jesus, when we open the Word, when we sing about it, it fuels our service. It's the driving force behind costly devotion. Mary was captivated by the glory of Christ, and it moved her to costly devotion. Mary didn't serve Jesus to make him love her. She understood how deeply he loved her, and understanding that was the motivation to serve. That fueled her devotion. Listen, Christian, you don't need costly devotion to make God love you, right? Rather, when you begin to scratch the surface of how deeply God loves you now, how secure you are in that love, how he would pursue you when you were a rebel before Christ, how you, the chief of sinners, me, the chief of sinners, that he would go to the cross so that I don't have to. That love motivates me to serve. That love, him moving into pain and into suffering for me when I didn't deserve it, it motivates me to enter into the suffering and the pain of other people. It ignites in me a desire to break open and pour out all that I have. This is in part why we gather each week as a church and why we should gather each week. Well, we sing about it, right? Like we sing about it today. You're the God who fights for me. You're the Lord of every victory. Hallelujah. We pray about it. We preach about it. It fuels our service. It kind of resets our heart. It reminds us why we're here, why we do what we do, to then leave and to go and to minister and to be the hands and the feet of Jesus. But worship fuels service. Worship fuels costly devotion. Listen, everybody here needs Christ. Maybe for some here, you're kind of like Judas. Okay, you're along for the ride. What's in it for me? Right? Maybe you're here to make your parents happy. Or maybe you're here because your parents are like, oh, no, you're going no matter what, okay? All right, I've been there. I grew up in church like that, right? So maybe you're here because of that. Maybe you're here for your spouse. Maybe you're here for your girlfriend. But I just want to say, like, listen, understand that's not genuine faith. Right now, your spiritual condition is like Judas. You're spiritually dead. You need to repent and believe and receive life in Christ yourself. Your parents' faith, your girlfriend's faith, right? Your husband's faith, it won't save you. You must repent and believe. And Christian, you need Jesus too. You ever feel like those days where your devotion is waning, where your love for others is waning? I think that we've talked about this a lot, how specifically during these last 6 months, I was just reminded by Fitzer today, it's a 6 month anniversary of 2 weeks to flatten the curve. Right, thankful for that, okay? I think during all of this, right now, I think it's a lot harder to love people because, like, my little world's all upside down and I got to wear a stinking mask everywhere and I got this giant head and they don't make masks big enough. Like, you know, like, that's one of the problems, okay? You know, I went to lick an ice cream cone, I had a mask on, like, what in the world's going on there? Okay, all that stuff, 1,000 reasons. It's really hard to love people. And people are harder to love right now. And they're uglier. And their tempers are shorter. All of those things, right? It's a difficult time. Maybe we feel our devotion and our love waning, right, for others. That's why we need Jesus too. And we need a Jesus reset every single week. Mary's devotion fueled her worship. So we need to turn our eyes back to Christ and his heart for people and the way he entered into the pain and the suffering of others. Maybe your prayer then, Christian, is, Father, reveal in me where my devotion is lacking. What are your priorities? For some, maybe the stronghold is finances. For some, maybe that stronghold's about their time, right? And so our heart change is a priority change. That's what it is. This is what John Piper says here about Mary's heart. Mary's heart corresponded to the treasure that Jesus is. Judas' heart contradicted the treasure that Jesus is. How beautiful it is when the hearts of the followers and the worth of Jesus match. When you lose your life for his sake, when you lose it, you'll find it. And that costly devotion is a fragrance that fills the whole house. Other people can't help but be affected by devotion like that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, I want to pray here today for those that are here that maybe are like Judas. They're here for wrong reasons. We're glad they're here. We're glad to hear, and I pray that today they would see, Lord, that their parents' faith, their husband's faith, their girlfriend's faith, it won't save them. Lord, that they must turn and repent and receive Christ. And I pray that today would be the day of their salvation. And I pray for those of us here, Lord, that admittedly are struggling in our devotion. Maybe it's a result of just lack of attention and worship towards Christ. But our devotion's waning, and we recognize it, and the Spirit's pointed out. And so I pray for grace today, Lord, that you'd show us. Lord, show us. Give us a fresh vision of who Jesus is through the Word, through the singing and the preaching of the Word. And may it motivate us to costly devotion, right? Costly service. The instruments are going to play, and here's your time to speak with God.